Got a new number for you, Brady. It's another biggie. 10 to the 272,000. Again, we have done bigger, but this is bigger than a Google. It's quite a lot bigger than a Google, actually. So this number, Brady, is the latest estimate on the number of universes that you can get out of string theory.
Does that mean if string theory's right, there are that many universes existing, like multiverses, or that's the number of different...
It's kind of, yeah, you would think of it as the size of the multiverse. So do they all exist? That's hard to say. But they could all exist, and they may all exist. But yeah, I wouldn't want to say confidently that they're all existing now. There's the potentially, that they could all be found at some point in the history of the multiverse. Why are there so many possible universes that you can get from string theory? You might have heard the number 10 to the 500 used in this context. That was the old estimate. That goes back about 20 years. This goes back about 5-6 years. This is the sort of updated estimate. But okay, where does it come from? So string theory is a sort of, as we know, is our best candidate for a quantum theory of gravity. But the funny thing about it is a 10-dimensional theory. So what does that mean? It only really makes sense in 10 dimensions of space and time. And that goes against what you normally think about because, you know, we experience 3 dimensions of space and 1 dimension of time. So there's 6 left over in string theory for it to make sense. So what we normally say is those extra 6 dimensions are wrapped up very, very small, so small we can't see them. Okay, so there's a very, what we call like a compact shape, a compact manifold that wraps up these 6 extra dimensions. Now, the original hope is that, you know, you'd wrap it up in one particular way and then you'd get the you know, a single unique universe would pop out. It turns out that there are lots and lots and lots of different ways you can wrap up these 6 extra dimensions. So the way you can think of them, think of a torus maybe, and you can see that has cycles, one going round that ring, another one going round this way. General sort of shapes that you use to sort of bring this string theory down from 10 to 4 dimensions, they have so much structure, so much complexity, that when you count up all the possibilities, you start arriving at some very big numbers. Not just that, it's not just the shapes that are important, it's what you can do with those shapes. One of the things you do is you have, in string theory, you have analogs of magnetic fields, and you can sort of thread magnetic flux through these extra dimensions in loads of different ways. And again, that adds to the different universes you have, because for any given shape that you pick, you get a very particular structure of the sort of leftover 4-dimensional world. And if I choose one shape, I'll get 1 4-dimensional world with certain particles, certain forces, certain just structure there. If I choose a different one, I'll get something different. So they all give something subtly different.
I mean, I'm not going to pretend I understand what you're talking about, right? But as I understand it, you know, there are all these different ways to pack the hidden dimensions.
Yeah.
One of those packing configurations results in the universe that you and I are living in right
now.
Absolutely. Do we know what that one looks like?
No.
Right.
We've never been able to come up with one that gives what we see. So it's a very good point, actually. So it's actually a really great point. So there are huge numbers of possible universes that you can get out of string theory. You just do this counting game. You know, there are constraints on how you can put these magnetic fluxes through these weird and wonderful shapes. And when you do this, you get this counting. Actually, this estimate comes from using something called F-theory, which let's not worry about what it is, but it gives you a way of calculating the vacua universes in a certain type of string theory called type 2B. That's a technical detail. Your question was, do any of them look like our universe? Actually, all of the ones that come from this counting, and this is a bit of a secret, they all have what's called negative vacuum energy. Now that's a bit of a disaster, because vacuum energy is the energy that you have left over when you sort of take everything out. So you take out all the planets, all the stars, all that, you have vacuum energy, the energy of the vacuum, empty space. So you could ask, is it positive, is it negative? You might, or is it zero? You might think it's zero, but generally it's not zero. In all of these cases, it's negative. The thing is, in our universe, we expect it's probably positive, right? And the reason is because we see the universe accelerating, and that positive vacuum energy will cause an acceleration.
This doesn't lead you to think maybe string theory is wrong?
No, not yet. It's a curious one because, okay, so one of the things, I mean, something else could be causing the universe to accelerate. It could be that we're in one of these vacua, that we're in one of these universes, and that the vacuum energy is very small but negative, and what we're experiencing at the moment is just some excited state above that, and actually we're still at positive energy, and we're going to roll eventually. Dark energy itself will settle down to nothing, and then we'll end up in this vacuum. That might be a way out that you could imagine quite easily. Well, not easily. No one knows how to do it, but you could imagine it. So yes, there's this huge number of vacuum, and a huge number. I'm saying vacuum because what I'm really talking about, what you're counting here, are actually the vacuums of the theory. Okay, and the universe that you would get is this sort of excitations about it. You know, you sort of start putting planets and stuff in there. But this is what we're counting, different sort of baseline points you can have for each of these.
Sort of like the different foundations.
Exactly. I started thinking about what some of them might look like, actually. So this is where I started going off on one and having a bit of fun. Different shapes will give you different properties of the underlying universe. When you've got so many as this, some of these universes can be really, really big. So they're all got negative vacuum energy. Now, when you've got a universe with negative vacuum energy, it's guaranteed to end after a certain time. Vast majority of these universes will end almost instantaneously. They'll barely exist for any time at all. Those which have a very small and negative vacuum energy will live for much longer.
More stable.
They're more stable, yeah, exactly. Now, there's some of them are going to live for a really long time, like much longer than our current age of the universe. Like, this huge number allows that. We can imagine that some are really, really long lived. And I started thinking about what would it be like in those places when you've been around for a really, really long time? How would technology develop, for example? Has technology developed to sort of gargantuan levels? So I started thinking about Moore's Law, you know, the computing power will double every 2 years.
Of course, a really long-lived universe doesn't guarantee really long-lived inhabitants.
Absolutely, and this is what I'm coming to, right? So I said, okay, so let's imagine Moore's Law applied. Computing power's doubling every 2 years or something. And let's suppose you try to do it for the kind of length of time some of these really long-lived universes are going to give you. Then you quickly get to, you exceed the allowed bounds. There's a nice paper by Seth Lloyd where he says that the maximum amount of computing power you can have for a kilogram-sized computer is about 10 to the 50 operations per second. You're going to go sailing past that point. In fact, you're going to find that you're going to have to start making bigger computers so that you can fit more energy into it. And then you're going to get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger until eventually you have to start building computers that are reaching all the way to the cosmological horizon. And you still have got nowhere near where Moore's Law would theoretically take you. Right, so there's no way you're going to get, you can just keep developing technology in these places. You're going to have to hit some limit very quickly on the wider timescales that we're talking about. And then something's got to give, right? Either it just stays stable. I think much more likely is that it crashes down and society ends, you know, they've become so technological, they've learned also how to destroy themselves as we have. And then it starts up again, and then it goes down again, and then it starts up again, and then it goes down again. That's one possibility. The other is that there is a way to sort of get around some of these bounds. The big thing, the big obstacle is that you need to start adding energy to the system to get more computing power from them. And you want that not to turn into a black hole. So the way to stop things turning into a black hole is to weaken gravity. Now it's possible because of that some of these funny shapes that again are leading to much weaker gravity theories. Gravity is much weaker in these universes. So it might be that in some cases, gravity is weaker, which means these bounds limiting technology are much, much weaker bounds. You can get much more technologically advanced and much faster computing power from these things. And that would be really cool. So you can, in some cases, you might get really, really beyond what we can even comprehend, advanced civilizations. In fact, if you've got weaker gravity, as there would be in some of these universes, you can find generally everything's much more complex. For example, stars live for much longer. If stars live for much longer, that also suggests you've got more time for things to evolve. Things are going to get bigger, going to get better and cleverer and cleverer and cleverer and cleverer. It's going to be much more advancement. So when you start thinking about these multiverses and all the things that can happen in them, I think you're just talking about things that are completely unimaginable to what we could even comprehend, like levels of technology that are just off the scale, beyond even the bounds that we think exist in our universe, that they're not even restricted by those. And I think that's an amazing place to be.
If string theory is correct, and there's some number, at the moment it's that number there, but there's some number of possible universes, mm-hmm. would only one of them actually come into existence? Would all of them have a chance? Would any exist simultaneously? What does that number actually mean? Like, how many of those?
That's a very good question. It's not a question we can answer without much better knowledge of string theory. What you're really asking is, how are these universes distributed in all the range of possibilities? And it might be that some of them are much more likely than others. We have no idea what that weighting really is. We just don't know it. We don't know string theory well enough to answer that question. So it might be that some are much more preferred, in which case you would say that we're much more likely to be in one of those universes. You ask the question, can they all exist? Again, that's a question you can only really answer with much better knowledge of string theory. What can happen generally in a system with, say, two vacuums, two solutions? You can have bubbles of one appear in the other. So you could start off with a universe where everything's in one particular state, then a bubble nucleates of the other state, and then a bubble's nucleate, and you get this percolation effect. You could have something like that at a cosmological level, and these new universes start to appear, and then universes start to appear in universes, and that could happen. To be sure it happens, you have to know about the transition, the nucleation rate of these bubbles. And you can't know that without much, much better knowledge of the shape of what's called the string theory landscape, which we just don't know. We don't have the tools yet to calculate.
You told me there are these 10 dimensions, three that we're quite familiar with, time, and then these six little ones packed and hidden away.
Yeah.
Are all of these universes you talk about here examples like that, where there are three out in the open, time, and six hidden? Like, is that just limiting us to that configuration?
Yeah, yes.
That's, like, could there be a five-dimensional universe where there are five hidden?
Yes, exactly. You could imagine that. There's certain assumptions that have gone in here. One of the assumptions is that you've gone down to four dimensions. The other is that you've gone down to four dimensions on a very particular type of shape, which are these calabi-yaus, which guarantees a certain amount of symmetry, guarantees stability, it guarantees you can actually trust your calculations. So there might be many more things that you could consider. We just haven't figured out how to calculate, we haven't figured out how to make sense of them. And yeah, absolutely, you could imagine scenarios with other dimensionalities.
I sometimes hear that mathematicians and physicists can think something's right by gut or instinct. They may be proven right or proven wrong in the fullness of time. Does your gut or instinct tell you that string theory is on the right track here?
It's a very difficult question. I think string theory is a magnificent theory. Should I take this amount of universes seriously? Should I take the multiverse seriously? It's very early days to do that. I mean, at the moment, this is just a counting game. They count the number of solutions that you could get. There's so much more to ask. Are these even all consistent? Do these even all make sense? Or is it a subset of them that makes sense? Which ones do make sense? You know, this is ongoing research. So one of the things that I think people sometimes criticize string theory for is they say, oh, you're talking about these multiverse, you're talking about all these possibilities. It's not testable, it's not. But actually, string theories aren't being that reckless. They are looking at these and really trying to understand, do these actually make sense? This was just a counting game, but let's try and actually really build one and study what it does. And can we actually get it? And that's what people are doing. And there's this whole Swampland program trying to understand that. And I think there's actually much more rigor than perhaps I think maybe the wider community realizes going on by string theories. They're really pushing and probing their theory to try to understand better. What is the meaning of these numbers? What are the meaning of all the universes that appear? Can I trust them all? And where is our universe in all of that?
For more big numbers and mind-boggling cosmology, why not check out Tony's brand new book? It's called Fantastic Numbers and Where to Find Them, A Cosmic Quest from Zero to Infinity. There's a link in the description. And to really give your brain a workout, you should be visiting our episode sponsor, Brilliant. I've told you countless times about their great courses and lessons, filled with interactivity, designed by real pros. But in a world going crazy with Wordles and Sudokus and the like, you really need to check out Brilliant's daily challenges, like these ones here. I love them. They're always really cunning, but they've also got like a sense of humour. That's another thing I like about Brilliant. It kind of makes you smile. To check them out, go to brilliant.org/numberphile. Using that URL will give you 20% off a premium subscription. Again, check out the links in the video description.
It does My problem with it is that it's completely untestable, as far as I can tell, in that, you know, this idea that the sun is just one star, for example, it's a hypothesis. And then you learn more and more about other stars out there by observing them, by making observations of them, and then actually you find, yeah, it's true, actually the sun's no different from any other star. The multiverse, as far as I can tell, we can't test physically, because the idea that there are other universes out there, well, how do we communicate with them?